Thanks for the nice introduction, and many thanks for the invitation to be part of this nice celebration day. Vijay, thanks for the invitation to be here. And when I thought about talking about the vision, about the change in paradigm of non-destructive testing, and also thinking about our way together, Vijay, we had a lot of contacts. I think we started in 1997, 98 or so, but with Thomas Wenzel first time. And we started to renew our business, I think, the last 4 or 5 years with Norman. And it's getting, I think, nice products that we created together. But there is actually one scenery I never will forget when we met in Munich. I don't know if you remember. We sat in a beer garden, and it was late afternoon, beginning evening, and we enjoyed the nice weather. I think it was autumn or something like that, similar year here. It was in 2003 or 2004, and discussed about further collaboration, and I had a call at my phone, and I said, excuse me, I had to get to my boss. And, my boss also sat in Munich, and he was discussing with the Secretary of State, and he asked me, hey, Randolph, I have 10 million euro. Do you have an idea for a project? But we need to spend it immediately. I need a plan for the next 2 weeks. Say yes or no. Of course, I said yes. Well, it was a nice evening for the rest of the day together with Vijay. And we started a project which was called Development Center for Non-Destructive Testing in Aircraft Industry. And during that project, we generated some new ideas where I will present also today in this presentation some results. The one thing was robot-based computed tomography, or let me say in the first beginning robot-based radioscopic imaging, and the other thing was high-energy X-ray tomography with linear accelerators. I will present that. So talking about the next 10 years, you said we have to fulfill or to create a vision. And I say the way will become reality only if you go the way. Yeah, I think that's very important, not to think about what could be, but let's do it, let's walk the way, and let's realize. And even though there are some obstacles, I think you will have to overcome them, and you will create new ideas never you have thought about that when you start to think about that. Okay, so I will begin with my presentation. Do I have a presenter? Thank you. The future of NDT, and in the future I don't longer want to talk about non-destructive testing. I talked in the last month a lot of a change in paradigm in thinking about non-destructive testing. Non-destructive testing usually is committed to work in the production range, yeah, to have a quality check, to measure specifications of objects, and to be in the production environment, I think. But what we know and what we can do with X-rays, and not only with X-rays, but also with all the other non-destructive technologies like ultrasound or thermal imaging or whatever you want, we can talk in the future more about cognitive, intelligent sensor systems, yeah, for non-destructive monitoring, and what is important not only in production but in the product life cycle. Yeah, I will present you what I mean with the product life cycle, what it means, and it will open up a lot of new challenges and a lot of new business areas where we can work and where we can create business in the future. First of all, you mentioned I have different jobs. I have a chair in the university for X-ray microscopy. I'm director for the Center for Development for X-ray Technology in Fürth. That's located in Bavaria. That's, by the way, is the high energy X-ray hall facility. And this is my institute in Saarbrücken for non-destructive testing. Here we do all the stuff with X-rays and also with optical inspection technologies. This is a technology facility, and these are the offices here. And in Saarbrücken, we do all the things like ultrasound, like thermal imaging, like eddy current, and all the complementary technologies for cognitive sensor systems. So these are the locations. The annual budget that we have to earn and that we have to work for is about 32 million euro, was in 2016. That means that we have about a staff of about 230 full-time scientists and technicians engaged at the three locations. Fraunhofer is, I don't know who is familiar with Fraunhofer. Fraunhofer is an organization which is not directly university, but it's public funded. But not totally public funded. About 30% of the money of the 32 million euros is coming from the state. And the rest of the money, the 70%, we have to earn by ourselves. So we have to make business, we have to make contract research, go directly to the industry. And that means that we, as a Fraunhofer, bridge the gap between basic research on the one hand at the universities and about industrial application on the other hand, yeah, and make things run, not only create paperwork, but create prototype systems that we transferred to the industrial partners like WeChat Technologies, and from the prototype development that we do, WeChat and other partners will make out of that products and will sell them to the market. So that's my job to do that at the different places, and now I come directly to that what I want to present for the future. I told you about the product life cycle. I told you about that there is not only product testing. Yeah. So this is what we talk about NDT, non-destructive testing, today. We talk about quality of components and products, looking at the specification and so. Sometimes we look at maintaining the objects or the products in the during operation. Yeah, like inspection of aircrafts under operation, yeah? And sometimes we talk about materials and materials analysis to understand the characteristics, yeah? But analyzing the added value chain of material, yeah? From the very beginning as a raw material, yeah? To the material, yeah? To the product development, getting the material a shape, a structure, yeah? To the production process by itself, to the product which coming out from the production, to the way when the product is on the road to the end customer, to the aging questions in maintaining operation, and at the end of the day, the recycling process. Yeah? All these processes have different needs for non-destructive testing or for cognitive sensors. So that's not only non-destructive testing. Yeah? Non-destructive testing, quality testing is here. Here, in that case, we do sorting. We identify and appraise the raw material. That's quite different. Yeah, what has to come out of the sensors. Yeah, in materials we analyze the characteristics of the material. We want to understand the behavior of the material, but not of a product. Yeah, we do microscopic imaging here. In product development, we have to understand. I will give you some examples. What's the difference between product and product development? We have to understand which way has the product in the future to be enhanced, to be improved. What can we do for that? Yeah. Then we have the production process for itself. We have to monitor, think on additive manufacturing, yeah? During the process, monitoring, understanding what happens, and maybe in situ change the process, yeah, not to become bad quality. Then we have the classical product testing. And in that case here, it's very interesting, especially in the field of e-commerce, yeah? We have to manage what happens with the product coming to the customer and maybe coming back to the product, to the supplier. Yeah. So in e-commerce, you order something, you look at that, and you say, no, I don't like, and send it back. What happens on the way here? Yeah. Is there a loss in worth, a loss in quality, whatever happens? Yeah. Okay. And then you have the classical operation process. At the end of the day, you have recycling, identification, appraisal, and sorting materials, which is closed, and then you have closed the loop. Yeah. And you see, you find that here explained, yeah? And you can do that with the sensors, different agents like computed tomography, that means X-ray photons. You can take ultrasound, you can take optical photons, magnetic resonance imaging, thermal imaging, electromagnetics, microwave, and so on. What we can do in the future when we talk about this product life cycle, we can create feedback loops, which means we look into a single stage here. Yeah, to optimize, for instance, production. Not only to get an information about the production process, but to work with this information and to adapt the process. Yeah? And
can you tell an example?
I will give you examples for all that in the next, thank you, for the next, in the following situation. I just give you a first overview about that. Yeah? And that's what you can do for every process, making a feedback loop to adapt and to optimize the different processes. Yeah. But what is in the future much more interesting is what do we learn from cognitive sensors, from non-destructive testing, for instance, in the operation process, what could help us to enhance and to improve the materials research, the product development, changing the construction, the structure, yeah, maybe from crashes or from aging, yeah, or to the production process itself. So nobody really investigated the interstage influences of these different processes. Yeah, what can we learn from all these single processes to optimize the other process in the future? So this is the whole picture in the future, and I will give you in the next 15 minutes some examples. What does it mean in every step to make non-destructive testing or developing intelligent sensor systems? So what I just mentioned, you can have a look at the intrastage effect. This is something like that. You're processing something, you're measuring something, you're evaluating something. Yeah, and usually you decide if is it scrap or is it good. Yeah, but you not only need to decide if it is crap or is good, you can quantify that in the future. Yeah, and then you can link this information of the objects to the process control. Give you an example for pistons, for instance, what we have done with inline computed tomography within the last 10 years and which will be enhanced now. When you look at a radioscopic image during the production on a piston, on an aluminium light alloy piston, you will find some defects inside and you will decide this is okay or no, if you meet the specifications or not. But it would be much more interesting to have a production process which doesn't produce pores and holes. Yeah? But just from the mere information of a radioscopic image, you can't decide what of the production process parameters has led to the pores and the holes. But you can make inline computer tomography, and then you get an information about the shape, about the structure, about the position. You get a really characteristics of the defect, and then you can correlate the defects with the production process parameters. And you can decide what was responsible that pores and holes appeared in the piston. You can link that. We made a lot of simulations with the process people. Yeah, they understood their process. They said, if you change temperature or if you change pressure, then you will have pore holes, blow holes at this position or whatever. Yeah, so we can link that. Yeah, and that we can, by quantification and by inline computed tomography, help to enhance and to manipulate and to optimize the process parameters and then restart processing and then to avoid scrap production. Yeah. So this is an inter-feedback loop inside of a production process. Yeah? The other thing is, and it's much more complicated, to have an interstage feedback loop. Yeah? So once again, you see the different steps, the different phases of process, raw material, and so on. Yeah? And then you can have a shell of different information. You start in the inner part with this sensor technology. That's the physics, where you get the information about your material. Yeah? Then you start to develop virtual methods and models inside to have that in the computer. You evaluate all the data. Yeah? You create data handling to let the data that you gain in the different processes to migrate around the circle. And then you use artificial intelligent algorithms to exploit the data, yeah? To find out what do the operation people need, for instance, from the product development to enhance their processes. So this is future, of course. Today, I don't know what is the impact of the different processes to each other. But we have to look, and it depends, of course, on the material. It depends, of course, on the product type and whatever. Maybe not for all products, every of these 8 steps will be relevant. We have to find out what's relevant and what's helping to make the products more economic and more optimized in them. So these are the 2 points that we can learn from the product life cycle to have an inter and intrastage or phase interaction. So let me summarize it up. So the cognitive sensor system for the future, along the product life cycle, the product life cycle defines what we learn, what we have to learn from our materials and objects, will be material near intelligent sensor systems. I will explain what that means, intelligent sensor systems, adaptive sensor systems, and we have a sensor near intelligent data analysis. This should be combined in the future together. Yeah, a holistic consideration of the data analysis, of course, yeah, and expanding the industrial 4.0 data space by data information about material modifications. Yeah, I call it in the future smart materials data. And the smart materials data is that data, yeah, in which the material or the product is changed by influence of machines, of humans, or environments. Yeah, these are the main influences that change the materials. It's summarized in that slide here. Have first a look at the left-hand side. This is standard. You have in the beginning, you get data and collect data and data. Google is doing that, yeah? And then you have big data, yeah? A lot of sensors which provide you with a huge amount of data. And then you use data analytics to find information out of the data. Yeah, that's big data. Yeah? And from that information that you gained from the data, you will create a reaction, yeah? Whatever you want to do. And usually today, if you talk about big data, you talk about, in the production field, about factory data, about logistics data, about cost data, processing data. All these data are collected and put into a big data for data analytics and to lead to process control. But all that guys don't have really smart materials. I learned a lot of people who said, oh, we don't need it. Yeah? If we have all this data, we know about the quality, we know about the process. We all know that's not true. And the most people working in the reality of manufacturing know that they need materials data. Yeah? But they don't need, we have to find out what materials data are relevant. Yeah? So what we want to do in the future is to come from the big data, yeah, not collecting everything, to the relevant data. Yeah? To that data that we need, yeah, to control and to enhance and to improve the processes. Well, processes of material development, of production, of production specification, of operation, of recycling. So all these different processes, yeah? And so what we need is to combine these two things to create materials data. We have the non-destructive testing sensors, yeah, like ultrasound, CT, computed tomography, radioscopic, yeah? And then afterwards we get a huge amount of data, yeah? 3D, 2D, time resolved, and we make an analysis. But it is much more interesting to know if we had measured at the beginning the right data. Yeah? Usually today, we optimize our system to get the best image. But depending on that, what I want to do in the future, maybe the best image is not the optimal image. Yeah? So we need to make the sensor intelligent. I call it adaptive sensing. Yeah? So we start to measure something in situ or whatever, yeah, online, offline. Then we start to analyze, and then we realize, ooh, we measured too sharp, we measured too good, or we have to get another position, yeah, to get the information, yeah, or we can stop measuring, we have all the information, yeah. So given a feedback of the data analysis in situ to the data acquisition, yeah. I give you an example what it means, yeah. If you start to make computed tomography, you standardly said, okay, I provide the system, I see I have the object, and I say, okay, we need 400 projections, 800 projections, whatever, yeah, and we need this incremental scanning, and we need this energy, and we need this position, and we need this pre-filtering, and whatever, you all know this stuff, yeah? Who tells me that this is the right parameters, and who tell me if it's the right parameters for the information that I need to extract? Maybe instead of 400 projections, 100 will be much enough. Or instead of 160 kV, 100 would be better. That's just intuitive, yeah? So we have to make the sensor intelligent, yeah? To give him the information, what we want to extract from it, yeah? And then let him decide by himself in which way he should measure. Because we have a space of parameters that's much more than one or two parameters in X-rays, yeah? We have the energy, we have the pre-filtering, we have the number of projections, we have the resolution, we have the magnification, yeah? We have a lot of parameters. We have the position of the object, yeah? Who knows what is the right position for a computed tomography, for the best or for the optimal computed tomography? I will give you an example, yeah? Look at this trumpet, at this hornet, yeah? So we are interested to understand the mechanism This is an antique and an old trumpet, I think about 200 or 300 years old, so we can cut it. And we have no CAD data about that, yeah? But we want to know the mechanism inside of that. So we put it in a CT and we decide take that and that energy and so, and make a computer tomography, and then we get this image, yeah? You all know the nice artifacts that we have and say, oh, nice, we have to change a little bit or so, we will get better. There's one parameter which is very important, which we found out, that just the position of the trumpet is very important. So we started to simulate and to find a measure, yeah, to evaluate, to quantify the image quality here inside, yeah, by, we made a model of this object, yeah, because we have not a real reality, yeah, and we made an X-ray simulation of this inside, yeah, and then we skipped the trumpet in different angles and performed many CTs in the computer, not in the reality, yeah. And at the end, we could find, this is the result, by skipping the trumpet for exactly 45 degrees, we got a maximum of quality, yeah? We get the best results compared here, keeping all the rest of parameters identically, yeah? Just by getting a different positions, yeah? We get different qualities. So, and now you can do that for the energy, you can do that for magnification, the number of positions and so on, yeah? But this can't be done by humans further on. That can be done only by artificial intelligence and the sensor itself. Yeah, provide them with that what you want, and the sensor will decide what is the best solution to create, characterize them, organize himself. So, summing up, cognitive sensors, you can read all that, that's not important, but the most important sentence is this: sensor machines for the future will decide independently how, when, and what they measure and monitor. That's what I think about a cognitive sensor, yeah? And which way they decide and which way they come to the decision depends on the question we tell to the sensor, yeah? Do I want to characterize the material? Do I want to sort raw material? Do I want to derive parameters for the structure? Yeah, do I need to monitor a production process? Yeah, whatever. So always depending on the different processes I will have to monitor and look at, yeah, different questions will be sent to the monitors, cognitive sensors, yeah? And they have to decide themselves in which way they what measure. That's a vision for the future, yeah? And it's written down in that short slide. The future is a black box with an intelligent sensor system consisting of, for instance, robots, yeah, communicating robots, and they decide which modality they take. If it is best to take an X-ray, if it is best to take a thermal camera or an ultrasound system, whatever, yeah, the system may know it much better in the future. Yeah, we give the object and we give the question, and the system decides which modality in which way will be performed, and then only provides a result. That's what I discussed with people from, for instance, BMW. They said it's a vision, but that's what we want to have in the future. We want to be, we don't want to be experts in NDT, yeah? We want to have a question solved, yeah? And please help us solving the question without providing us the energy, the engineer of your system, yeah? Or making our people to experts in managing the systems. The system itself should do that. But it's a vision. I don't know if it will be run in the next 5 or 10 years, but I think we are on the way to that, especially also with robot-based computer tomography, to design systems that for all components, materials, and problems, parameterize, teach us, and optimize and adapt them themselves. Yeah, that's something where we want to go in the future, and what I'm calling cognitive sensor systems for monitoring, okay? And now let's go to this product life cycle. We start with raw materials, giving you some examples what I mean for that. Yeah, go for sorting and identification of an evaluation of raw materials for detection of raw diamonds. You see, this is a kimberlite material. Norman, if somebody is interested more in details, can explain what we have done. In the mine, I think it was in Siberia, Norman is right.
Russia,
yeah, anywhere where we installed a system, and by dual energy sorting, we could separate, yeah, by using a low and a high energy image, we could separate and quantify what we need. So the customer was interested to differentiate between silicon, which is kimberlite, and carbon, which is diamond. So two different element numbers, yeah, and you know X-rays are sensitive to the atomic set number, yeah, and using two different energies and combining these two methods will lead to a quantitative imaging, yeah, and this is no longer a gray value image, this is an atomic set number image, Yeah? So the white spot is giving you the carbon, yeah? Which shows you this is diamond and the rest is not diamond. Yeah? So and that helps you to make to sort raw materials. We are not interested in the points, so we're just interested in the atomic number. Yeah? And this is running in a mine by dual energy on a conveyor belt. Another thing is exploration petroleum recovery, which we have done with a company in Belgium. I think I can tell Shell developed a CT scanner for analyzing long bore drill cores, yeah, to understand the behavior of flow of water and salt water passing through the rock, and to understand what happens there. That's not what we need, but that's what the guys to understand if they have a good chance to find the oil. Yeah? So they need a CT system, yeah, which was capable to have a long core scanner. Yeah? Not just 1 meter or 5 centimeters, but 3 meter, because they want to understand what happens with the liquids passing here through the system. We developed also by dual energy and helical computer tomography a system which is capable to scan the complete long core. Of course, it leads a certain time, not just seconds, but they have time enough, yeah, to scan and to analyze the behavior of liquids passing through this rock, these rocks. Yeah? So this is some examples when we start in raw materials. There are, of course, much more. Let's go to materials analysis and characterization analysis. You told everything changing, but nothing happens really. Yeah? A lot of things happen and nothing changes. Yeah? You talk about microcomputer tomography. Some people talk about nanocomputer tomography or submicron, but they all are shitting us, let me say. 0.8 microns are not a nano. Yeah? So what we have done in the last 10 years is to develop really nanocomputer tomography with a resolution down to 70 nanometer, really image resolution inside of the CT images. Yeah? Not just 0.8 microns, yeah? Which is 10 times worse. Yeah? We upgraded a special electron microscope. Yeah? We just use this as an electron source. Yeah? Electrons are created here, are accelerated and focused here on a small needle. This is self-produced here with a tip diameter in the range of about 70 nanometer. That's tungsten. Yeah? And then this will be illuminated and will send photons in a range up to 30 keV. Yeah? With a focal spot size of a real focal spot size, maximum 70 nanometers. And we have a nano positioner inside here. It's all in vacuum. Yeah? And then we have the absorption of the X-ray photons. And by the way, we have also refraction. This is also something which is new. We have learned about phase contrast imaging maybe. And you know, if you have a certain coherence of the X-ray beam, and we have a lateral coherence here because of the very, very small focal spot size, we can also create refraction images, yeah, using the interface, interference effects, and can create the phase contrast imaging. And outside we have a detector, yeah, and then we can create these nice pictures here. This is a 25 micron diameter aluminum alloy. Yeah, so this diameter is 24 microns, very, very small, and is created by a focused ion beam system, yeah, and gives you, with an electron microscope, the pretty nice surface images. Yeah. But you just get the surface. You don't get information about the structure inside. Yeah? If you want to do that, you have to use, again, the focused ion beam to cut it step by step. Yeah? But by X-ray tomography that we have performed in the same machine, so we can do electron microscopy and X-ray tomography, yeah, we create then this radioscopic imaging. And by applying special algorithms for reconstruction, by just 200 projections, not 1,000 projections, but just 200 projections, we can create this 3D image where we can very nicely look at the 400, 300 nanometer structures here, and going down to the range of the resolution of about, let me say, below 100 nanometer. Just to give you an idea what it means, not only to get the results of the sensor, that's just state-of-the-art reconstruction without any pre-processing and intelligent processing. And that's what we could gain at the end after working on the raw materials, on the raw projections of the CT. So that's what state-of-the-art reconstruction already looks pretty nice. Yeah? But that's what really is an information inside of the same projections if you apply intelligent pre-processing and certain reconstruction technologies. Then, coming from a very, very small resolution, going to product development, we started to build up an XXL, an extra large high energy X-ray computed tomography machine. That's what you can see here. This is a linear accelerator with 9 mega electron volt X-ray beam, a fan beam. This is the turntable. You can read all these explanations here. And this is a line scanning camera. I think one of the guys who supported us and supplied us this from Detector Technologies, I think, of Finland is here, was installed in 2013. And what do we do with that? We do help the car constructors to understand, for instance, in crashed cars, where is the energy absorbed? Yeah. So they are not interested in analyzing the quality or whatever. They are interested what happens during the crash. A crash is very expensive, and usually they simulate the crash first, yeah, and then they got a certain idea what happens, where the energy is absorbed, what is changed, yeah, and then the reality usually is quite different from that. And up today, they destroy the cars, they cut it, they photograph it, they digitize it, and they compare it, yeah, and it needs weeks and weeks to get this information. Putting this car in the computed tomography, we need about 6 to 10 hours, yeah, to get these images, and then we evaluate it, and then we get the CAD data of the different components. Give you a short film here that gives you a feeling about that what happens making computed tomography on a complete car for helping the construction people to change maybe the architecture of the car inside. So this is an example for helping people in the field of product development. This is the escalation, what we will do in the next step for the next 5 years, hopefully. We will mount the complete scenery, as you see here, a LINAC and a X-ray line scanning camera on a gantry. Yeah? This gantry will have a diameter in the range of about 8 to 10 meters. Yeah? And then we will move the gantry and the detector around and help to analyze the containers to understand what is inside, to compare it specification what is inside of the freight papers, yeah, with the freight papers, and to see if they write a declaration to help the custom and to detect explosives and so on. Yeah, so this is the realization of the first step here for concrete analyzation. This will have a diameter of about 6 meters here, and it will be realized in the next 2 years, and then upscaling up to scanning complete containers. Just to give you an idea what happens in the field of extra large computed tomography within the next years. Then we come to production. I told you that we use robots for bringing. Which way I can start the film? There's during my talk, somebody should. I think I can do it myself. Yeah, now it's running. Okay. Yeah, that's what we also do together with the company Erd and Abt. So both robots are corresponding. Yeah, one is the master, the other the slave. Yeah, and then we can bring the computed tomography into production, not by standard granite systems, yeah, but by robots, which can use every position. So the future is that the robots can become intelligent. So who tells me, because of the structure, it's not like the human body from every position the same structure, who tells me what are the right perspectives to get a computed tomography? Yeah. So we are sure, yeah, that some perspectives are much more relevant than others, yeah, depending on the structure, yeah. And this the system will decide by itself, and then we will put all this information in the computed tomography and then reconstruct by a region of interest computed tomography within so-called ART algorithms, and then we are capable to perform CT directly in the production year environment. This is an example here of a combination. Of a connector here between a fiber, carbon fiber reinforced plastics, yeah? And here you see the a single slice, a direct comparison between a standard laboratory micro CT, which is left here. This is a slice of this object, yeah? Of that what I just demonstrated you with a 3D image, yeah? And this is created by the robot CT, yeah? And I think the most important thing is that you need for the robot CT the real position. Yeah, the standard robots are not capable to perform a 30 micron reposition of the object. So what we have done within the last 10 years to calibrate the robots and to learn the position in the range of about 50 microns preciseness accuracy, yeah, by so-called calibration of the robots by the X-ray images by itself. So we give the robot the positions, 20, 30, 40, 50 positions, go there, yeah, and then he will go there, and the accuracy will be in the range of plus minus 1 millimeter. And from the X-ray images, we calculate the precise, the actual position of the robots and put it in the reconstruction. That's the only way that you can have a chance to make computed tomography with this resolution in the range down to 45 microns. Okay, we do that also for additive manufacturing, I told you, with optics and with thermal imaging. I will have to hurry up a little bit. Then we go to product control. I give you an example of the food inspection. This is a sugar beet, yeah, which is prepared then in millions and billions of particles. And it's also a production process, and we have to understand the quality of the sugar beets if they are germination about that. And we make a CT. Further on, before we had a CT, they cut it, put it under the microscope, and looked inside and said, okay, this is good, this is not good, yeah? But it's very a long process and not really satisfying. And now we can do, in 1 minute, about 500, 600, 700 sugar beets inside, make a CT image, and create out of the CT image the parameters that gives us the quality of the produced product, yeah? And then they can help to make, to qualify the product in A, B, C classes, yeah, related to the germination of the seeds. Yeah. So this is full automatic product quality control, and maybe also we give feedback to the production process in the field of sugar beets, yeah, which helps them. I told you what's interesting, e-commerce trade. Imagine you want a new shoe, and you go to the internet, and you find a nice shoe, and you order that. But you don't know the real size of the shoe, and usually, at least in Germany, and at least with my wife, we order two or three pair of the same shoe with different sizes. And then they will deliver, and then we'll try and say, oh, this is okay. Yeah? And the rest of the two shoes, in the optimum case, will be sent back. Every shoe which is resent will cost at least $8 to $9, every shoe. And imagine what a high amount of money is lost on the roads. We pay that, not the companies who provide the shoes, yeah? Okay? I can tell you it's $3 billion alone in Europe, in Germany, which has to be paid for this resending. What we have done, and this is again Aired and Up company, we work together, yeah? We have constructed a computed tomography machine, which is capable to scan up to 6,000 shoes in 24 hours, yeah? And it's not interesting to understand the quality of the shoe, yeah? Or the material behavior, whatever, yeah? Just to have the inner shape of the shoe, that's important, yeah? And today, at least in Germany, and they're discussing also with American companies, with Zalando and Amazon, Amazon is American, at least at the shopping floors in Germany, at Intersport or at Sportcheck, or so different bigger providers and suppliers of stores, you can get a digital image of your optical image of your food. Yeah, you can go to the shop and they scan your foot, and then you get an identification in the data bank of your foot. You can make it also with an app of your handy and make a photograph, send it to the company Mifito. Yeah, they will extract the shape of your foot, left and right one. Yeah, and if you order a shoe, yeah, because I think up to now 2.5 million data of shoes, of different shoes, they compare it, they fit it, and send you the right shoe. That costs you about 8 or 9 cents. Yeah, but you will just get sent and delivered the right shoe, and not two or three pair shoe. Yeah, that's a new idea, and you can expand that to every kind of clothes. Yeah, what happens when what I told you at the beginning? If you order a shirt, yeah, you wear it for one certain situation, and then you decide, oh, I don't like that, to have it in my board. Yeah, and send it back and say I don't like it, but you wore it already. Yeah. And it lost something on worth. Or you order a nice, not you of course, yeah, but some others, a nice watch, yeah, and you replace a fake or something like that, yeah. Who will control what happens. Currently, just people look at the packages and look if it's okay or not. So thousands and 10,000 of packages coming back. So cognitive sensors who will decide what is the quality of the resend systems will in the future decide by chemical or physical sensors about the quality change in the trade or in the transition. So coming to trade, another thing is I mentioned container inspection, of course. Yeah, this is a nice image of a scanned container. And you see we can unpack it by digital way without opening the container, and we find a rifle, a shotgun, yeah, and explosives and something like that without opening the container. Yeah, we need with a reduced resolution about 20 minutes in the future to scan the container and to get this information. This is the future. Yeah. Also, trade and non-destructive testing. Going to operation to understand, for instance, here a pulse for lamps, street lamps, and something like that, to understand about the corrosion inside of the earth. Yeah, we use ultrasound for that because it's a little bit difficult to do that with X-rays. Yeah, but we also can use non-destructive testing to understand if the light pole is still working for the next 1 or 2 or 3 years. And we developed some systems with surface wafers and reflection on corrosion positions inside of the earth. Yeah, and at the end, coming to recycling, yeah, which is very close to raw materials, we again have to decide by more or multi-energy selective X-ray inspection and by neural networks to differentiate with different energies between different materials. Yeah, and then we will give with a complete system a sorting decision. And I show you with my last slide an example which we already have realized. Yeah, for electronics, disassembling to separate between button cell and battery, yeah, from the plastics and from all the other things, which has been done automatically. And the decision to sort and where is which position is done by a neural network. Yeah, and this we also develop not only a sensor to inspect the quality or whatever it is, yeah, but to separate and to differentiate between different materials in the recycling process, to give you some examples. So with this slide, I want to finish and hope you have got an idea about all the new opportunities and what I mean when I talk about a paradigm change in non-destructive testing. Yeah, to go from an just a sensor, which is operated by human beings, to a sensor which operates by itself, yeah, by communicating with the production or recycling or maintaining process by itself. Yeah, many thanks for your attention.